So we're in the series called Unwrapping God's Gifts. And I want you to know that you have a job to do. You might not even be aware of it, but you have a full-time job. Besides what you do right now, here's what your full-time job would look like in the spirit realm. Okay? You are a security guard. Okay? Your security guard, first and foremost, for your own soul. Now, what I want you to remember from today is this simple thought, is guard your gifts. Okay, would you say that with me? Guard your gifts. So when you're having lunch later on, you're going to say, guard your gifts. When you're getting ready to take a nap, guard your gifts. When you're walking around later on, right? Guard your gifts. Now, let's suppose that we live in a country where there are no banks. There are no safety vaults. And you have been given a special gift. Let's say, ladies, you were given a gift that came down from your great-grandmother, the grandmother, the mother to you. And it's a very special diamond necklace. Really special of the family. Now, would you take that special diamond necklace and throw it on the kitchen table and leave your residence in a hurry and leave the door unlocked and just kind of wander on down the street? Would you do that with something that special? Okay. What do you do with things that are special? You guard them. Okay. We're going to talk about somebody in the Bible that took something really special and treated it like an old rag. The man's name was Samson. And the story of Samson can be found in Judges chapters 13 through 16. How many of you have ever read the book of Judges? Okay? Good. Now, I'd like to just explain a little bit about this book, just to kind of present the setting, okay? Judges is a very important book because it's a link book in the history of God's dealing with people. God's dealing with the nation of Israel. All right, now think with me. Back in the time of Moses, Moses was used by God to see the deliverance of the Israelites out of slavery, out of Egypt. They came out of Egypt, they came to the Jordan River, crossed over the Jordan River some 40 years later, and then under Joshua, who followed Moses, they started to possess the land. And then after Joshua, the Bible talks about elders that outlived Joshua. Now, it was after that time of the elders that the people started to drift away from God. Now, this is a very sad cycle that we see over and over again in the book of Judges, where the people would be close to God, but then they would start to become lazy and careless, and they would slip away from God, and everything would go wrong in their life, and they would become slaves again of the neighboring nations, and all kinds of, like, you know, oppression would happen in their life. And they would start to cry out to God, and God would raise up judges. These judges, they were not kings, but they led the Israelites out of bondage to that particular nation that was attacking them or that was enslaving them, whether it would be Moab or the Ammonites or the Philistines. And so Samson, in the book of Judges 13 to 16, is one of those judges, the last judge, in fact, of the 12 judges of Israel, before they have a king, okay, before the time of Samuel and the first king Saul. So Judges is that link in the chain between the time of, you know, the Joshua and the Promised Land and the kings of Israel, the book of Judges. And a sad commentary in the book of Judges about the spiritual climate at that time goes like this: and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Okay, so there's a lot of chaos. There's a lot of moral confusion going on in the time of Judges. All right, now let's focus on Samson. Samson had an inspiring beginning. All right, I mean, this was such a promising young man. In fact, even before he was born, his parents had trouble conceiving children. And God came to them in the angel of the Lord and said that they're going to have a child, and this child is going to be blessed. The Bible says in Judges 13 and verse 24, the woman, this is Samson's mom, gave birth to a boy and named him Samson. He grew and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to stir him while he was in Manahathan. So here we see this young man, he has godly parents, he's learning about the things of God, he's growing up, and the Spirit of God is stirring him. The Spirit of God is in him. Great, wonderful. But there's something missing. Samson doesn't believe that God is enough in his life. He believes in God, but he is not going to have God as his pursuit or as his satisfaction in life. And so Samson is the kind of person that takes it upon himself that says, I have to find my own way besides God. And so what happens is, Samson doesn't do well at guarding his own soul. Now, what I want to say to you today is this, is guard God's gifts by guarding your heart. You know your heart is important, right? The heart is the inner person. Proverbs says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Your life really begins with your heart. What you think about, what you focus on, it's the heart. So, what does Samson, here's the question we're going to ask as we look at this man. What does Samson's life teach us about guarding our heart? All right? Here's the first thing. Samson's life teaches us that God's calling and his gifts are special. Okay? If you're a believer in Jesus, then God has called you. And whether you realize it or not, you have talents, you have gifts. Your calling may be a calling to marriage, it may be a calling to a certain type of work, it may be gifts that you have to help the body of Christ, but you have talents, you have gifts. Amen. And so, we see here that God's calling is upon the life of Samson. God sets him apart. It's so interesting that when the angel of the Lord came to Samson's parents before Samson was born, the Bible says that this angel gave instructions to both parents about how Samson would live. He would be actually a Nazarite. Let's take a look at what the Bible says. The instructions were given to the parents that no razor may be used on his head, because the boy is to be a Nazarite, set apart to God from birth, and he will begin the deliverance of Israel from the hands of the Philistines. Judges 13, verse 5. So, what does that mean to be a Nazarite? Well, if you look in the Bible, in the book of Numbers, chapter 6, you see that God made provision for people who wanted to enter into a special vow, a special dedication to God. And so, Numbers 6 says that if a person wanted to be a Nazarite, whether man or woman, then they would have to do certain things. They would have to refrain from alcohol or any kind of drink from the vine. They'd have to refrain from unclean food. They'd have to distance themselves from dead bodies. And most of all, what would be the most visible outward sign of a Nazirite would be that their hair would not be cut. They would have to let their hair grow. Now, the Nazirite vow could be for a period, a short time, or it could be, in Samson's situation, for his life. So a person walking down the street would recognize, like, oh, okay, that person has a vow upon them because this person has really, really long hair. That was Samson's situation. And the hair comes in really important later on in the story.
Yes.
Now, we know that Samson was given a gift of great strength. Samson was the superhero of the Old Testament. I mean, he was the Hercules of the Bible. It's amazing feats that happened. The first occasion that we get of Samson's strength was when Samson was walking with his parents down to a Philistine city where Samson had seen a young Philistine woman. He said, oh, she's going to be my wife. And so the parents are coming down to meet this woman. And Samson is not walking, you know, like really close to his parents. I mean, maybe he's far ahead or whatever. But a lion happens to jump on Samson. And the Bible tells us that on this occasion that Samson takes this lion and handles it like he would a young goat or a baby lamb. He just kills and destroys this lion. Not only does he do that, but you read later in the scriptures, and there's one time where Samson is inside of a city called Gaza, a Philistine city, and the people find out about it, and there's soldiers that are ready to take him. But Samson gets up in the middle of the night, and he takes the gates. Now, if you ever watched any old movies of ancient history and the gates, we're not talking about doors this size. We're talking about doors about the size of this wall. And he takes these gates, which are made of iron or bronze, and he picks them up, the roots, the bars and all, he carries them miles away and drops them off just to kind of show off his strength. And not only does he do that, but on one occasion when the Philistines think they have him surrounded and they attack Samson, he picks up a jawbone of a donkey and he kills 1,000 Philistines with a jawbone of a donkey. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't have that kind of strength. The most probably powerful thing he does at the very end of his life is he pulls the temple down. Thousands of people that are the enemies of God and enemies of Israel perish along with him. And so, with all these things that Samson has, he has the Spirit of God in him. He has the spirit of a supernatural power that comes upon him. Now, I don't believe that Samson looked like the Incredible Hulk. Probably Samson didn't even exercise. It was a gift that God had given to him. It just came upon him. But, unfortunately, Samson doesn't guard his gifts. So, guard your gifts, because God's gifts require what?
Character.
Say it with me. Character. What is character? Character is the formation of Jesus Christ within the believer. Now, character is lacking in Samson's life. Listen to this. When I was studying this week, I got this amazing quote. Listen to this. Samson tried to lead Israel, but could not lead himself. He strangled a lion, but he couldn't strangle his lust. He broke ropes, but he was bound by his appetite. He burned the Philistines' crops, yet he was inflamed with desire for the Philistine women. He was strong, but not really in control. The champion was captivated by the enemy and conquered by himself. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. So, character is not just God, the ability of God to work through you. Character is the ability of God to work in you. Just yesterday, being at my in-laws, I was talking to my sister-in-law, very godly young lady. We've known her since I've known her since she was 6 years old. And she was saying that where she works, she was so surprised to discover a lady that works there that she's a Christian. She's so surprised to discover that she was a Christian. Because she had a need, this lady had a need in her life, and my sister-in-law asked her, "May I pray for you?" And this other lady said, "Oh yeah, sure, I'm a Christian too, you know, praise the Lord." But then my sister-in-law went on to say that of everybody at work, this particular lady is the most mean, vicious lady. Everybody has to walk on eggshells around her because they don't know what mood she's in that day. You know, isn't that sad? It's like, God's purpose is not just to, you know, get us to a place where we say that we're Christian. His purpose is for Him to work in us. Because when we are followers of Jesus, it's not just the power things that we do, but it's the demonstration of the life of God Himself. We represent Jesus. So, character. The Holy Spirit is not just in us to make us feel good. I want the Holy Spirit. I'd love to feel the Holy Spirit. Yes. But it's to go ahead and work something powerful. You know, a couple weeks ago, I was called on to look at the refrigerator here because it wasn't working. The big refrigerator. It's like, you know, like, what do I know about refrigerators? I get called on to do a lot of things here that I say, hey, Lord, that's why I have a bunch of phone numbers when I call them. So anyway, I go back and I look at this refrigerator. Everything should be working. Should be. It's plugged in. But something's missing. We discover, okay, it's plugged in, but what's missing? Well, we can't get the power source working. So I think to myself, all right, let's just go to the breakers, right? When all else fails, check the breakers. Sure enough, the breaker had been tripped or whatever, so we just flip the switch, and guess what happens? Power again. Right, I wish all my problems could be solved that easily. But everything is in order, but the breaker isn't switched. And I think to myself, you know, being a Christian, it's not just having everything in order. We have to also be broken. Right? A person who's not broken, a person who says they're a Christian but they're just living for themselves, is a disaster waiting to happen. So, Samson. Character begins with self-leadership. I was in Bible school, and it was kind of funny being around my, you know, classmates and myself as well. You know, we all have these big visions of like, oh, you know, we're leading, you know, we're going to be, you know, leading hundreds and thousands of people. And guess what? God says, lead yourself first. Because if you can't lead yourself, you can't lead at all.
Amen.
Leaders are just followers.
Amen.
All right, you with me?
Yes.
So here's what the Bible says about this area of temptation. Each of you should learn to control his own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the heathen who do not know God. 1 Thessalonians 4:4-5. Have we ever, at any other time in the United States, been at a time where sexual immorality is so out of control? Folks, it is really crazy. I mean, crazy. This stuff I see, I can't even talk about. I see it on the streets. I see it. You know, it's like, really? We don't even allow that to happen? We're going that far? Nobody's saying anything? So, we have to understand that if a person doesn't have God, that's all they have in this life is passionate lust. It's like eat, drink, and be merry, because who knows what's going to happen later. But how are we to live? We are to live in a way that reflects God Himself living in our bodies, in a way that's holy and honorable. So we're to have self-control, because self-control leads to self-respect.
Amen.
Show me a person out of control, and I'll show you a person who starts to hate themselves because they have no respect for themselves.
Amen.
All right. Character. Now, what else does Samson teach us? What does he teach us about guarding our gifts? Number three is this. Is God's gifts can be squandered. Okay? So God has done, you know, great things for us. He gives us His mercy. He gives us His presence. But then we can be like a security guard. How many of you want to hire that person again? Excuse me, Mr. CEO, but someone broke in last night. I wasn't really aware of that, but they took a lot of papers and files, and you know, sorry about that. I was just asleep. I really was very tired. And I had a lot of problems with my family. I'm sure you understand. So, Samson, really, this guy believes in God, but he's asleep. He's not guarding his own soul. We see this when the Bible says that Samuel one day went to Gaza, which is a Philistine city, and he sees a prostitute. Okay? Now, men more than women are visually oriented, which you women know that. Okay? And so men can think, I mean, I'm sorry, they can see a lot better than they can think often. And so, Samson sees a prostitute, and he doesn't really see much of a big deal. Sex is just a little side show anyway, you know, so. He goes in to her, spends the night. Now, one thing we don't see in the life of Samson, you don't read about this, is you don't read that Samson was seeking God. He's really not a person who seeks God in his life. Now, we see him praying a couple times, but his prayers are 911 prayers. Right? His prayers are after he wins a battle, he's exhausted, he's dying of thirst. He says, God, do I have to die like this? You know, help me out. And so God sends some water his way. So a stream opens up and blesses him. So, you know, and then another prayer he prays is the last prayer of his life when he's blind and he's by the temple. You know, God, remember me in my two eyes. So Samson in his life is not seeking God. And could I just share this with you? One of my prayers, one of my burdens for this church is, God, stir the people of Highway to seek after God. Not just to know God and know that He's there, but to really pursue Him. Because you're not going to stumble your way into discipleship. The only way you're going to be strong in God is through just discipline and focus and concentration. You're going to have to want this. You're going to have to say to your soul, as a leader of your soul, so no matter what you go through, you're going to seek God.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
Our natural tendency, our natural flesh is lazy.
Right.
We don't want to go after God. In fact, there's a lot of people right now that, you know, probably yesterday was saying, you know what, yeah, I think it's a good thing. But, right? You have to be, you have to want and you have to pursue.
Amen.
And so, Samson is not guarding his own soul. And another place in the Bible says, sometime later, he fell in love with a woman, a Sorek. Oh, this was his undoing. Yes. Sweet Delilah. Her name was Delilah. Yeah, she was bad news for him. Judges 16:4. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about this expression. He fell in love. Okay. Sometimes people come up to me, and they say, you know, Pastor, I was really going along well in life, and then all of a sudden I fell in love, and it was the wrong person, and I made a huge mistake in my life. Well, let me just say this. You don't fall in love like you fall and trip over a curb on the sidewalk. Okay? It just doesn't happen that way. Some people think, well, I just didn't have any control over this. Falling in love is an expression that we give once we have made a commitment inside that we're going to go after that person. When you make a commitment, when you see someone and you, even though they might, you know they're not going to be good for you, but you say, wow, I really want that person, then what you're allowing yourself is you're allowing your emotions to be the leader and everything else will follow. So falling in love is a decision that you make.
Amen.
Please remember that. It's not something like, wow, I was just minding my own business and somebody just slapped me in the face. No, not that at all. Not that at all. Okay? You can control this. This is something that you and I, you know, we just don't fall in love with everybody that we see. We control this.
Amen.
Just wanted to help you with that because our society doesn't get that. People are married for a little while, and they say, oh, you know, I just had a divorce because I fell in love with somebody else. I wasn't really trying, but it just happened. Come on, be real.
Right.
It doesn't just happen.
That's right.
Okay. All right. Now, back on my little path there.
preach it.
Yeah. Preach
the truth.
Okay. And so, Delilah was the worst thing that could ever happen to Samson. All right? Oh, you know, she's so sweet, and she's so pretty, and she's so cute. Wow, this is life change. Yeah. So Samson, I know you might not be able to see this picture, but he's with Delilah, and they're playing their little game. Their little game is like, you know, the fox and the hound, and this, you know, Russian roulette all mixed in. And so the Russian roulette game goes like this. Delilah is going to get a lot of money from the Philistines if she shows the leaders of the Philistines the secret of Samson's power. So Samson's playing the game. Oh, you know, if you tie me with ropes, then I'm just going to be powerless. So he gets tied up, and he must be really, like, you know, stupid is as stupid does. But, I mean, he's got to be the stupidest person because he's in this room, and there's Philistines that are in the room, too, and he's sleeping. And Delilah says, oh, Samson, the Philistines are here. And so he just breaks the ropes, and he says, okay, where are they? Let me at them. And then she ties him up again, and then she takes his hair and puts it in some kind of a, you know, a loom, whatever it is, and he breaks that. And finally, she has the biggest weapon of all. She nags him to death. I know you ladies never nag the man you like, but she did. She nagged him. And she's going on saying, oh, you don't love me. You know, of course, he didn't love her anyway, you know. They're just playing this stupid game. And finally, he just breaks down and says, you know what? I'm a Nazarite. And the symbol of my hair on my head is a symbol before God, before others, and the power of God. And that's what God uses to give me strength. So she sends out a quick text to all the leaders of the Philistines saying, bring the money to me because he's told me the secret of his power. So Samson, he must have slept a lot. But anyway, he was sleeping again. And there's a guy comes and he cuts off his hair. And not only that, poke his eyes out. And he becomes a slave. Can I just tell you something about sin? Sin will introduce itself to you as a servant, but it won't take long before it switches seats and becomes your master. You got that? Oh, it'll be your servant. For example, you know, drugs or whatever. It'll come to you and say, oh, I'll make you feel so much better. I'll give you such a great high that you'll just be so, you'll be so happy in life, and you'll just love me, and it'll be wonderful. See, it comes first as your servant. I'll serve you. And you know what happens. It's not long at all before it becomes the master and it says, hey, you know what? You better obey me. You better steal from your relatives. You better do what I tell you to do, or I'm not going to make you happy anymore. All right. And so what happens is this. This is an amazing quote. Okay? I don't usually put quotes up here, but this is really good. You guys see this. Sin will take you farther than you want to go. Keep you longer than you want to stay. And cost you more than you want to pay. Wow. So before you think that, well, I'll just sin and it's no big deal, I'll just ask God to forgive me and there'll be no problem, please remember, sin is a deceiver.
Amen.
Because Satan is a deceiver. He's the father of lies. And so the Bible tells us that Samson awakes up from his sleep. And the Philistines are there. And he says to himself, well, I'm so strong, I can handle this. I'm going to go ahead and shake myself free just like I used to. But this is one of the saddest verses in the Bible. But he did not know that the Lord had left him. So he played around so long. He didn't guard his spirit. He became so careless. The Spirit of God had left him. So I ask you the question, and I search my own heart. Lord, what is it in me that's susceptible to sin? You see, every one of us have areas of weakness. It doesn't matter how strong you might think you are. Folks, even Superman had kryptonite that he had to watch out for. Right? So there's something that we have to be very careful that we have to watch out for in our life.
Amen.
That if sin for us is a temptation for us is over there, then we don't just try to go as close as we can to it so that we can prove how strong we are. No, we prove our wisdom by staying as far away from it as possible.
Amen.
Guard your life. Now, I want to end on a good note. Okay? Because we could end right here. The Bible could have ended with this statement. And Samson was a complete idiot. And he gave himself to sin. And he reaped what he sowed. The Philistines blinded him. He went down to the valley and just grinded grain the rest of his life and lived miserable and died. The Bible could have ended that story of Samson that way. And many people would have read it and said, serves him right. But aren't you glad,
come on,
that God is a God of grace too?
Yes.
Okay? That God is a God of grace?
Yes.
Hey folks, we're trophies of grace.
Yes, Lord.
You know, we're sitting right here not because like, whoa, I got it all together and you know, I'm the Samson of the Spirit here. No, we got it together because he has it together.
That's right. That's right.
The older I get, hey, can I tell you this? The older I get, the more I realize I can't trust myself.
Yes, Lord.
I'll just be honest with you. I can't trust myself. I gotta trust God.
Yes.
It's about the time when we think, well, I got this thing pretty much together, you know? I know how to do this. Boy, we're walking on some thin ice today.
Amen.
We don't have it together.
No.
No. He's our strength. Okay? Keep trusting. Now, God's gifts, can you praise the Lord for this?
Amen.
God's gifts can be restored.
Amen.
Oh, I'm so thankful for that. His gifts can be restored. So, Samson doesn't end as a complete failure. This is not the last picture of Samson's life. He's not just grinding the grain, blind as a bat. No. But as he's grinding the grain, his hair's grown back. Now, the Philistines were quite stupid. They didn't have anybody in charge of the barbershop. Nobody kept on cutting Samson's hair. So he's working, he's being oppressed and abused, and he's a slave, but his hair's grown back. Little by little by little. Isn't that the goodness of God?
Amen.
God restores us. Even if it's a little bit at a time, he's saying, I'm with you. You know, you haven't failed beyond, you know, help. I'm with you.
Yes, Lord.
So his hair's grown back. And then one day, the Philistines have a big party. It's the Dagon party. Okay? That's their god, Dagon. And they're in the city of Gaza. And they get all their dignitaries together. And I'm sure Delilah was with them too.
Yes.
Delilah was pretty rich, you know, at that time. She got 100 shekels from every leader, you know. She's just flowing in the money, you know. So she's probably all decked out, you know.
Yes,
you know, painted up just perfect. You know, she's at the party. And they say, bring Samson out.
Ooh.
So a slave leads Samson out. And they put him out in the center, where they have them do like little acrobatic stuff and sports. Everybody's having a good time because they're praising their big god Dagon. And so after they have their fun and they're drinking it up, they just kind of push Samson aside, and he's right between these two pillars. Whoa. Bad move, Philistines. And so Samson prays a final prayer, doesn't he?
That's right.
He prays a final prayer. He says, God, one more time. Would you give me strength just one more time? One more time. The Spirit of God comes upon him. And he pushes these pillars. And instead of party time, it's panic time. It's panic time. And we don't rejoice in people dying, but the fact is that their time was up. They had tested God long enough, and God was saying, I'm going to get rid of these people. And he uses Samson one more time. And Samson dies. He dies in dignity. He dies in an act that the Spirit of God comes upon him. And so the last story, the last note in Samson's life is one of God's Spirit working in him again.
Mm-hmm.
And did you know that in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, that Samson is also mentioned in the Faith Hall of Fame? Now, there's probably a little asterisk on the bottom. Not steroid use, but Samson had issues. You know, but he made it in. Do you believe? I believe.
Yes.
We'll see.
Amen.
Samson in heaven.
Amen.
You know, he's mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11.
Yes.
So when I get to heaven, I'm not going to say, Samson, what did you do with all those women? No, I'm going to say, Samson, praise God for the grace of God.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Because he's there.
Yes.
But you know, I guess the sad part is what his life could have been.
Mm-hmm.
The potential that he had. What could have been. So, my challenge to you today is guard your treasure. When it comes to the trash, throw it out. Okay? But guard your treasure. How about that?
Yes.
You guys ready?
Amen.
Ready to guard your treasure? Is there anything more important than Jesus in your life? When I'm guarding my relationship with Jesus,